Headline Audio presents Invader, Death Beach, the first in the Invader Novella series, by Simon Scarrow and T.J. Andrews, read for you by Jonathan Keeble.
Chapter 1. Kaleva, Winter AD 44. A chill blast of air swept through the headquarters tent as the new legate of the 2nd Legion strode briskly through the tent flap.
On your feet!
The camp prefect boomed to the officers seated inside.
Legates arrived!
The officers fell silent and instantly shot up from their stools, standing to attention as the legate marched past. Lucius Aelianus Sela nodded at the camp prefect, his hands and face tingling from the cold night air. He had only recently arrived from Rome to assume command of the Legion, and the miserable conditions of the island had come as something of a shock to him. With each passing day, he found himself yearning for the blissful warmth of his native Campania. Shaking off the cold, Sela approached a hide map suspended on a wooden frame at the front of the assembled rows of officers. A junior tribune stepped forward from beside the map and handed him a short wooden cane. Sela glanced at the camp prefect and straightened his back.
Thank you, Quintus Silanus,
the prefect nodded. Turning to the officers, Sela addressed them in his silky, aristocratic voice.
At ease, gentlemen.
An uneasy silence hung over the gathered men as they sat down. Even in the wan glow of the oil lamps, Sela could see the anxiety etched across their faces. Less than a month had passed since the 2nd Legion, under the leadership of his predecessor, Vespasian, had defeated Caratacus, king of the Catuvalorni, and the leader of those native tribes who had chosen to resist the Roman invaders. After a long and bloody campaign, Vespasian had finally routed Caratacus's army in a brutal pitched battle. Victory had come at a heavy price, with the 2nd Legion suffering grievous losses and Caratacus escaping from his captors. It was the end of the campaigning season. Winter was on the way, and the soldiers would be spending the next few months bottled up in the legionary fortress until the new campaign in the spring. Sela cleared his throat.
It's a cold night, gentlemen, so I'll keep this brief, he declared. In the past month, we have received numerous reports of attacks on our positions to the south. Patrols have been ambushed, forts razed to the ground, and naval supply depots sacked. We are not talking about the odd, opportunistic raid, but a campaign of coordinated attacks. The situation is so grave that I'm told even Greek merchants are now refusing to do business outside of our legionary camps.
That last remark drew a polite chuckle from his audience. Sela paused and half-smiled before continuing.
I know some of us had hoped that defeating Caratacus would bring peace to this benighted land. However, following his escape, it appears that our enemies have rediscovered their courage. The Durotriges have taken it upon themselves to redouble their resistance to our inevitable rule. My illustrious predecessor, Vespasian, may have conquered this territory, but he did not succeed in taming it. A failure I plan to correct.
Sela turned towards the map, depicting that large swathe of southern Britannia, which nominally lay under Roman control, extending east from the naval base at Rutupiae, all the way along the path of the river Thamesis, past Kaleva to the edge of the mountainous region to the west. Sela nodded at the map.
Our intelligence sources indicate that these attacks are the work of Durotrigan warriors operating from the Isle of Vectis.
He pointed with his cane to a wedge-shaped island situated a few miles south of the mainland.
During Vespasian's lightning campaign across their territory last summer, a significant number of the enemy managed to flee the hill forts. In Vespasian's haste to advance west, however, he neglected to turn back and deal with this rabble, allowing them to successfully withdraw to Vectis.
Sela turned back to the officers and tightly gripped his cane, his knuckles shading white. He continued.
From their base on Vectis, the enemy has been able to launch wave after wave of attacks on the mainland, retreating to the isle before our forces can effectively engage them. Gentlemen, it's vital that we subdue Vectis once and for all, and stop the Durotriges using it as a base to attack our supply chain along the coast. Accordingly, tomorrow at dawn, the 5th, 6th, 7th, and 9th cohorts will march down to the naval port west of Novi Omegus Regnorum. As we speak, a dozen galleys and supply ships from the Britannic fleet are sailing to the port from Rutupiae. Once our men reach the coast, we'll embark the ships, load our supplies, and make for Vectis.
There were low murmurs amongst the officers at the prospect of having to fight again so close to the bitterly cold winter months. Several exchanged wary glances with one another. A few men on the rear rows muttered to themselves. Sailor was unmoved. He raised a hand, swiftly silencing the room.
Thankfully, Fortuna shines on us. Over the past few weeks, our native scouts have been operating in secrecy on Vectis, gathering intelligence on the enemy. They have reported back that the Durotriges have no defensive fortification to speak of.
Sailor chuckled to himself.
As a matter of fact, they're still constructing a hill fort in time for the coming winter. If we act now, we can take the hill fort before the Durotriges have a chance to complete their defences, rout the enemy, and be back in camp before the first storms arrive.
He regarded his men with a smug grin.
The advantage will be ours. We'll have strength in numbers. The enemy will have nowhere to run. In addition, an advance squadron of ships has moved into position along the coast, cutting off their supplies from sympathisers on the mainland. All things being equal, Vectis should fall easily. Of course, there'll be the usual nests of resistance to stamp out. And once that's done, we can start dividing up the booty.
The mood inside the tent quickly lifted at the mention of earning a share from the spoils of war. Each officer, Sailor knew, stood to make a tidy sum from the captured natives, who would be shipped to Gaul and sold into slavery. Not to mention the treasure troves of ornately decorated weapons and jewellery, hoarded by the native aristocracy.
And we'll land here.
He pointed with his cane to a notch of land on the east coast of the isle.
The enemy won't be expecting an attack from the east. Acting on my orders, our scouts have disseminated false information to the Durotriges. They believe we will approach from the more obvious route to the north.
He drew the cane up the centre of the isle, to an inlet running up towards the northern coast.
And the east of Vectis will be mostly undefended, except for perhaps a token presence.
Sailor sought out a face among the throng and rested his gaze on a man seated on the front row. The man had bright blue eyes and an aquiline nose, and he wore a fine cloak.
"Tribune Paulinus."
"Sir?"
The man looked up and blinked.
"You'll be in charge of the 5th cohort. Your men will land first and secure the beach ahead of the main force.
Think you can handle it?"
Paulinus puffed out his chest with obvious pride.
"You can count on me, sir. I won't let you down."
"Good."
Sailor flashed him a thin smile before turning his gaze onto the rest of the men.
"Now then, any questions?"
A centurion at the back raised a hand. He was a short, pale man with dark, curly hair, and he lacked the scars of many of his comrades. Sailor regarded him coolly.
"Yes, Centurion Ocella?"
"Sir,"
Ocella began carefully,
"what kind of force are we up against?"
"According to the spies, several hundred at most,"
Sailor responded casually. He did not want to dampen the good mood.
"All the more reason to move now, before they have a chance to dig themselves in and reinforce their numbers. Of course, I would prefer for us to attack in greater numbers, but as you all know, the Legion is thinly stretched as it is after the recent engagement with Caratacus. Some of your own units are badly depleted. They'll be replenished with reserves recently arrived from Jessoriacum."
Legate tipped his head in the direction of the prefect.
"Silenus has been overseeing their training and assures me the men are ready for battle. Isn't that right, Silenus?"
"Ready as they'll ever be, sir,"
the prefect replied guardedly.
Quite.
Silo gave a sharp nod of his head. Then he handed the cane back to the orderly and straightened his back.
"Gentlemen, conquering Vectis is vital if we're to continue our advances in the next campaign season. General Plautius has ordered us to seize the territory which lies beyond the Durotriges. Some of the tribes in that distant region have already sent envoys to Kaleva suing for peace. The legate smiled. It seems our strategy of total war against the Durotrigans has shaken their neighbours. Which is as well, as the Emperor is very keen for this savage land to be pacified, so it can start paying its own way. His expression abruptly hardened. However, we cannot advance west as long as our supply chain to the rear remains exposed to raids. Any more questions? He looked round the tent. No one responded. Then Sailor nodded with satisfaction. Good. Then he gestured to an officer seated in the middle of the front row next to Tribune Paulinus. All eyes turned to a heavily built man running to fat, with a dark complexion that betrayed his southern Italian roots. In my absence, Senior Tribune Aulus Vitellius will assume command of the rest of the Second Legion, Sailor said. Some of you will already know the Tribune from the early days of the invasion. He's recently rejoined the Second after a spell in Rome. Prefect Solanus has been bringing him up to speed. Vitellius smiled slowly at the legate. And I look forward to fulfilling my duty, sir, he said in a deep voice, before turning to the officers and fixing them with his icy stare. Rome has its pleasures, of course, but I must say it is good to be back among true comrades. Sailor forced a smile to his lips. I'm sure Tribune Vitellius will make a fine commander of the Legion in the interim. Then he nodded curtly at Solanus and headed for the tent flap. The officers rose simultaneously and snapped to attention as the legate strode stiffly out of the tent. Vitellius and the legate's orderlies followed close behind. Once the legate and his entourage had departed from the tent, Solanus stood the officers down with a gruff reminder that they were to collect their written orders from the legate's secretaries before returning to their units to brief their men. The officers filed out of the tent and emerged into the icy evening. Although it was not yet winter, the weather had already taken a turn for the worse, a grim reminder of the long, hard months to come. As the officers dispersed towards their various barracks, Centurion Ocella snorted angrily. Wonderful, he muttered to his optio. Just bloody wonderful. What is it, sir? Ocella stopped in his tracks and glared at his recently assigned subordinate. He was a physically imposing man, broad-shouldered with taut, hardened muscles and a pinkish scar above his right eye. With his wild hair and stubbly cheeks, he had the makings of a competent, if unremarkable, soldier, Ocella considered. But he made a poor optio. He was hopeless at the day-to-day paperwork and administrative duties required of a junior officer. Whoever had originally promoted him to the post must have been desperate, Ocella decided, or plain mad. Now he was stuck with the burly Gaul. His last optio had died of an infected leg wound sustained in the battle with Caratacus's army, and the legate had taken the unusual step of imposing the optio upon him, denying the centurion the usual custom of promoting his own candidate from the rank and file, a fact which only increased his disdain for the man in front of him.
What the hell do you think, Figulus? Ocella snapped haughtily, bracing himself against the brisk wind. This mission! What with this foul weather and a sea crossing, it's taking quite a risk. And for what? To deal with a few pathetic stragglers on some remote isle?
He muttered a curse under his breath and looked away.
Meanwhile, the 14th and 9th Legions get a taste of the real action to the west and north.
He glanced quickly back at his second-in-command.
More spoils of war to be had there too, I'll wager.
Horatius Figulus pursed his lips. Despite his commanding officer's strong words, Figulus saw an unmistakable glint of anxiety in the centurion's eyes, and his voice wavered noticeably as he spoke. Figulus had been a soldier of Rome long enough to recognize Ocella as a ceremonial soldier, the type of officer who preferred kit inspections and nights of drinking, gambling, and whoring to proper soldiering on the battlefield. As was often the case with such commanders, Figulus sensed that Ocella was driven by a need to prove himself in front of his comrades, whatever the cost. Figulus shrugged.
I reckon we've got bigger worries than the size of the booty, sir.
Oh?
Ocella cocked an eyebrow.
What do you mean?
Figulus scratched his beard.
The Juratrigans are the hardest warriors in all of Britannia, sir. If there's many of them camped on Vectis, they won't give up without a proper fight. Hill fort or no hill fort.
And what makes you an expert on the Juratrigas, hm?
Before Figulus could reply, Acela stroked his chin and added,
oh, I suppose being half Gaul, you're practically related to these savages.
Figulus bristled slightly at the insult, but bit back on his anger. Although his father had served in the auxiliary cohort long enough to earn Roman citizenship, Figulus took quite...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.